Our next presenter will be Dr. Philip Wintersberger, if my pronunciation is correct. So he's a researcher at the Vienna University of Technology. He will talk about trustworthy and safe human-machine cooperation in automated driving. So are you ready, Philip?
I'm there. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah, first of all, thank you for the invite. I'm Philip Wintersberger from the Technical University of Vienna, and I did my PhD entirely on the topic on trust back then in cooperation with the Center for Automotive Safety in Ingolstadt in Germany. And I will use my time to talk about a few things that I believe are very important when we research trust, when we design for trust. I give a brief overview why trust is important, what it actually is and how it can be established, what is meant by trust calibration and how we can measure it. And finally, this brings me to what I see as what we should design for, the so-called trustworthy cooperation. But let's just start. So why is trust important? Actually, all the things that we hear now, they are not we aren't the first researchers that talk about trust in automated systems. And actually, the history repeats itself somehow. So when we look back on this cockpit of an airliner from 1933, we can see that actually this does not look so much different to what we have in our cars today. So the airline industry was one of the first that implemented complex automated features into their planes, and they also suffered similar issues. So there were different crashes, planes were coming down, and it also became gradually clear that some of these crashes happened because of human factor issues, including also trust. So when we look at the levels of automation as proposed by SAE, we can see there are different duties that drivers have to come up with when they operate an automated vehicle. And we can look at this in more detail, but I think there are two most important processes. One thing is the monitoring process, so that the user understands the system capabilities and limitations. This is mostly present on level one and level two driving. And there is also the issue of resuming control and on a higher level, this is becoming a multitasking problem. So a driver has to switch between multiple partly safety critical tasks, especially when it's the driving task. And so these problems, they were summed by Ansley as the out of the loop performance problem. And when we look at what the airline industry did to get rid of these accidents and to solve these problems, we see the following situation. So this is an aviation, a cockpit of an Airbus A320 today. And we can see that there are displays, knobs, status displays, performance displays. There is such a large number of displays that helps these pilots to safely bring the vehicle to the destination. And what is also clear when we think about cars is we cannot do that with automated vehicles because there is a big difference. The airline pilots are highly skilled and trained domain experts, and they have only one goal: to safely complete the trip and bring us to our destinations. As drivers of automated cars, they are not airline pilots. They might not be as skilled, they might not be as trained, and they might also have different goals, like talking to their kids or watching a TV show. Safety is of course important, but we can never be sure that it's the most important target for a particular driver that is out there. And I think this story is somehow important as it tells us we cannot just adapt all the findings that have been gathered in the relation to trust before the automated driving problems appear. So we have to research this issue with a different perspective today. So what is trust and how can it be established? There are different definitions of trust. I've put two here on my slide. So one is the Mayer and Shorman definition. It's trust is the willingness of a party to be vulnerable to the actions of another party based on the expectations that the other will perform a particular action important to the trustor, irrespective of the ability to monitor or control that party. A more prominent definition is the Leniency definition. It's the attitude that an agent will help achieve an individual's goals in a situation characterized by uncertainty and vulnerability. So in all these definitions, the vulnerability and the uncertainty are very important. So this means we have to somehow rely on another agent or party that we are vulnerable to. And in the driving domain that is safety critical, of course, all of that is achieved. So and then the problems start because trust is very, very complex. So I will list just a few of these so-called dimensions that came up in trust-related publications over the years, like the performance, purpose, and process definitions. Like trust is built on a possibility to observe the system's behavior, to understand the intended use of it, and to understand how it makes decisions. So that is important to build up trust. What was also mentioned was that there were analytic, analogical, and effective processes. And in the Leniency paper, it stated that there must be a link somewhere between the interface implications of so-called skill, rule, and knowledge-based performance and those analytic, analogical, and effective processes that govern trust. And I thought about that, how we could explain that. And I found a nice analogical analogy to that. So when we do not think of a car that we have to trust, but maybe exchange that with a dog. This allows us to simply explain it. So we cannot see in the dog's mind. It's completely working different to us. We somehow have to trust it. So I tell the story. Imagine you got a new dog and you are invited to your friend's dinner party. And at the dinner party, you have to decide if you unleash the dog or not. And what do? First, you have an analytic process. You think of, does my friends have small kids? How big is my dog? How dangerous might my dog be? And based on this analytic process, you decide, no, today I will not unleash my dog because I think it's dangerous. Then you have maybe, they have the dog for a year or two, and you've visited many different dinner parties. Then the analogical process comes in and you look at history and think, is there any situation that I've experienced already that is somehow analogical to the one that is now here? And you can use these memories to decide if you would unleash the dog at another dinner party. So this process might be a bit faster because you have not to deeply analyze the situation again. And if you use this dog over years and you have maybe visited all the dinner parties that might exist, so there exists an arbitrary number of dinner parties, but at some time you might get some intuition that immediately will tell you, is this situation, is this dinner party safe? Can you unleash the dog at this situation or not? And this tells us that the trust calibration, it requires an experience with a particular system and a particular machine in many, many different situations. The question is, can we as drivers, can we even get to the possibility to experience all this situation? Can we see all these situations? And is there enough time for us to get all the experience that we need? So we have to acknowledge that building up appropriate tasks requires a potentially long history of different actions in different contexts to really cooperate with the machine in the appropriate manner. Then there are many dimensions. So maybe you know this trust model by Hoff and Bashir. They would say we have this positional trust or situational trust varying on the situation. We have learned trust. There is maybe the system performance influencing our trust, but also design factors and all that adds up to what we call the reliance on the system. Or in the words, as I've been talking before, would we unleash the dog or not? Or would we trust the car in a particular situation or not? But this is not everything. There are also different types of trust, like in this paper by Hoffman, there is, for example, the unconditional trust of faith, where the trustor takes the trustee's assertions as true, whatever might happen. And there are different other types of trust, like the Swift trust, where The trustor has to take the trustee's assertions as true because of urgent circumstances, often on the basis of the trustee's authority or position. So I don't want to get over all this in detail, but when we reach trust, not only about trust, it is also important for us to know which form and component of trust we are actually looking for, or which one are we researching. So what is trust calibration? We also all know this famous diagram. So we say we have a certain performance of an automated system. And when our trust matches the performance of the system, our trust is calibrated. But there are also other things that are important. For example, the specificity or the resolution. And many, many papers that talk about trust calibration do not take these dimensions into account. So the temporal specificity says that changes in trust performance are resembled in trust. So when the system changes its behavior and it takes me way, way longer to adjust my trust, then I have a poor temporal specificity. And the functional specificity will tell us how good are we able to deal with our trust? How can we build up from the performance of different subcomponents or subfunctions of the car? To bring you a small example here, one of the papers that we did at the CHI 219, where we let drivers interact with an automated vehicle, and we varied the performance and the aesthetics of an in-vehicle entertainment system. And at the same time, we also varied the performance of an automated driving system. And we measured users' trust. And in the end, their trust was influenced by all the three dimensions. So also then we had a nice and a so-called ugly in-vehicle entertainment system. And also the aesthetics of this infotainment system drastically influenced how people trusted the whole car and how they also interacted with the car. So these are called halo effects. This means that when we have no clue on how we can judge the performance of a particular artifact, we just take other things into account. So like when there is this quote, when it's beautiful, then it's usable. I don't remember who said that, but it's a nice statement describing this halo effect. If we don't have enough information, just take anything and build our judgment on that. And this experiment showed us that there is a low functional specificity for most people when it comes to automated driving. So this means when we talk about calibration, we also have to discuss about resolution and this specificity. And also we have to consider a better control for these potential halo effects that might appear in our studies, also in our designs. So quickly to the trust measurements. That's also an important issue because there exist no direct measurements for trust. We have behavioral measures that measure reliance. So we can, for example, look at compliance or reliance rate. We can see if people activate or deactivate a system. But what we actually do here is we see would people rely on the decisions of the artifact, would people use the artifact, and that's not trust. That's some kind of outcome of trust in the end. Then we have physiological measures like monitoring or gaze behavior or stress measurements. They are typically used. And also those are just indirect measurements because many, many different psychophysiological constructs are measured with physiological measurements. So we can measure the stress. But is stress, is it only trust that is measured with a stress measurement? No, there are many, many other different concepts that use these measurements as well. So it's very hard for us to say we are measuring trust by using a galvanic skin response sensor, for example. So the only way to really measure trust is using scales or asking the users. So the users are the only ones that can really tell us how they would trust a particular system or not. And because of time, we quickly go over these sites. So there are some details on how we can measure compliance and reliance rates. We can also use the reaction times in certain situations to somehow infer, like an over-trusting user might take long reaction time because it would do something else, while a user not trusting the system would immediately react to a warning, for example. Or this is a nice example from Wiegemann, who looked at agreements rates versus the perceived reliability of such a power plant, and they conclude that there's a need to distinguish between the automation trust as a psychological construct that can be assessed only through subjective measures and automation reliance that can only be defined in terms of performance. And it's important to make these differentiations when we research and when we design for trust. Some slide about how we can look at use or disuse of automated system. This is a paper from Hunsinen from, I think, 2018. And they investigated why people deactivated an autopilot system. And they found out that lack of trust is, of course, one reason why people deactivate an autopilot, but it's definitely not the only reason. There are many other different reasons as well, what again highlights that we cannot just take these measurements and say we have looked at trust. Then there is this paper by Hergett that could show a correlation between subjective trust measurements and monitoring behavior in an automated car. I think it's a very nice paper. And also measurements like the one by Morris that they argue that higher trust comes with less signs of stress and low trust might result increased stress. So we'll take 1 or 2 minutes over, but I'm quickly done. And then we have these subjective measurements like the trust scale by Gian and Bizantz, and also we have developed a scale for the situational trust scale, automated driving, that looked at the situational aspects. And by that, we can somehow assess the trust of the user, but we can never use all the other measurements and say that is trust what we measured. But that's not a problem, actually. We only have to be precise about the factors that we really measure. We may need to assess multiple dimensions and relate them appropriately. And this really makes our papers and our research better when we relate those factors. And finally, what is trustworthy cooperation? So I say, I looked at in my work, for example, about what has emerged as interesting design factors for trust, and also what is there in the human automation teaming literature, cooperation literature. And I found out that many, many of these features or targets, they somehow overlap or maybe represent basically the same things with different words. So I think one of the important reasons is that we cannot design in a way, or we must design in a way, that trust-related failures will not happen, no matter if trust is calibrated or not. This means rather from the start, when a user uses a system for the first time, it must be prevented that certain trust-related issues would happen. And I have one small example here. We let people overtake from an automated car, and we found out that risky drivers self-negotiated somehow with the perceived urgency when they were typing and maybe delayed the takeover for some time. And what we did is we blocked the smartphones of these users so they couldn't type anymore. And this prevented all the participants from continuing the typing task. They had no option to just continue typing and immediately took over the vehicle. So there might be many, many different design factors that you can use to build up for this trustworthy cooperation so that you are not entirely relying on trust calibration. Short summary, we have to acknowledge that building appropriate tasks requires a history of interactions. It's not only about trust, it's also about important which form and components we look at. When we talk about calibration, we have also discussed resolution and specificity. We have to consider halo effects. We must be precise about the factors that we really measure and relate them appropriately. And to try to design in a way that these trust-related fails would not happen from the beginning. And with that, I took some more time, sorry for that, but now I'm done and looking forward for your questions.
Thank you, Philip. Thanks very much for the informative presentation. So do you have any question from the audience? Just raise your hand. Yeah, hello, Kai. I saw you raise your hand.
Okay.
Just don't forget, unmute yourself. We can't hear you now.
Yes, of course. I keep forgetting that. Hi, Philip. Thank you for the nice talk. So my question is about the last point of your last slide, where you mentioned that if you have a smartphone, for example, it could be blocked in the vehicle. And I'm wondering if this could backfire because people want to use their smartphone, they do it, they drive the vehicle, then it gets blocked, and then they might think, okay, I turn off the vehicle automation because I want to continue typing. And we had in the talk before this nice graph where we saw that more than 90% of the accidents actually come by human drivers. So if they turn off the automated system, they eventually come back through the human influence in the driving task. So do you have a point on that?
Yeah, thank you. This was a very dense presentation of all this work, so I didn't explain it entirely. So my suggestion would not be to just block the smartphone all the time, but to somehow integrate all these devices into some big system that looks at, would it be appropriate in this situation to use the smartphone? And in many situations where the automation is on, it might be appropriate to use certain functions, while in others, it might not. So I think in the direct onset of a takeover request, there is little discussion if people should continue using their smartphones or not. Actually, they should react to the car. And I think what we really have to take into account is we have been talking about task demands before. What are the demands of certain non-driving related tasks on smartphones? Which of these tasks would be fitting the complexity of the driving situation, and we can then make some kind of judgment on which activities which would be allowed to a driver. And we have to be more precise here, I think. We should not go for either we allow drivers everything or nothing. So there might be a much better line in between.
Thanks for the, okay, oh, we'll get another question. We are a little bit over time, but let's have another one. So, Yuri?
Hey, Philip.
Hi.
Just a really quick one. As you were talking about in your last slide, the number one conclusion about the example you had about the dog, where you say the user has to go through all these, through endless amount of experiences to understand the system better. I was wondering if there's any place for using collective intelligence to, shortcut things. So probably if I know that someone else crashed his car while he was reading a newspaper, I would also want to do that. So like, I don't have to go over other people's mistakes. I was just wondering if you had any thoughts on that at some point.
I think this is one of the big challenges in trust research in the end. To not have this long history for the users and to build on experiences of others might be one of these options. So, I have not gone into detail about the designs that we can use, like reliability displays or other explanations or XAI to get users faster and understanding of these systems in different situations. And I mean, basically, I would say you're fully right. I mean, we know it. We drive on the Autobahn and we might see these pictures on the side, like telling us like some person was using the smartphone, had a nice family, and unfortunately had a severe accident. And I think these are also examples of how the government tries us to make our behavior based on the experiences of others. So actually, at least I'm not aware of any experiment that would have investigated these experiences as a design method, but I would say that's an interesting idea to look at, definitely.
Cool. Thanks very much. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Thanks very much, Philip, for the presentation.
Thank you.
For the for answering questions. So for our audience, if you have more questions, just type your question in the chat.